wrong of man's creator. He readily acknowledged that those in his care did not belong to him. They belonged to God. His was not the role of the father. He simply did as instructed by his father. And in his obedience, Christ taught these lone men the true meaning of discipleship. Christ knew that God had only loaned these men to him. What had Professor Jesus Christ taught? Now, when you got Jesus Christ as a professor, you know you're going to learn something. Just saying, what had Professor Jesus Christ taught? What was the second important connection Christ made between God and man? Jesus Christ had carefully unveiled to his disciples and the world that our Heavenly Father knows all. He is aware of all and understands all. The greatest of man cannot comprehend his limitless knowledge. He is omniscient. Our Heavenly Father is almighty and infinite. No man can dissuade his power. He is omnipotent. Our Heavenly Father is all-enveloping and present everywhere at the same time. He cares for the birds of the air and the lilies of the field just as readily as he cares for the fragility of man. No one is denied his love, and no one will escape his wrath. He is omnipresent. That word, omnipresent, I looked at it. It means that he's everywhere. That means that church members, visitors, Christian friends, when you go out of town and you think there's no one around who knows you, you still have to be on the Christian P's and Q's. Because he's omnipresent. He means he's everywhere. You can't go out of town, and like we used to say in the old days, kick up your heels. Because every time you kick up your heel, Jesus is there. He knows everything. There's nothing you can't hide from God. There's no place you can go. He's not there. There's nothing you can do that he don't know about it. That's why you always be on your Christian P's and Q's. What it says, Christ has manifested the personality and characteristic of his Father. He gave the disciples a visual concept of the one true and living God. I want to kind of key on that. The one true and living God. Because today we get our kind of concept of God. But there's only one true and living God. There are things today in the media that they are trying to get us to accept what is not of God. There are things they're trying to get us to do what is not of God. There are places they're trying to get us to go what is not of God. I have to tell you what they are, because when you look at something, whether it be on television, radio, newspaper, magazine, if it's not scripturally correct, then it's not of the true and living God. That's why I always like to say that's Bible and not Billy. Because you can't go on Billy's doctrine. Because Billy might lead you down a dark alley. You got to go on Jehovah's doctrine. You got to go on Jesus' doctrine. You got to run with the Holy Spirit. I know we hit the ground running in April, but when you hit the ground running, you better put Jesus in front of it when you hit the ground running. something that's not of the true and living God. But remember this. If it's not scripturally correct, I'm not talking about Methodist, I'm not talking about Baptist, I'm not talking about Catholic, I'm not talking about Coptic, I'm not talking about Buddha, I'm not talking about posting me, I'm not talking about none of that. All I'm talking about is scripturally correct. And if it's in the Bible, it's correct, because there are no errors in the Bible. So beware of people that come to you and say to you one thing, but you must ask them, is it of the true and living God? Now let me hurry, because I want to get to connection three. I have given unto them the words which thou gave me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. This was the final necessary link. It says that he came out from thee, and they have believed that thou did send me. Now that's important. Because everybody didn't believe that Jesus was sent by God. I even believe today, when I look at the world, when I look at from lifestyle, when I look at some actions of people, I just believe today that there are some of us that still don't believe that Jesus was sent by God. Because we can recognize everything but Jesus Christ. We recognize every strange doctrine under the sun. We'll take the most ungodly thing and try to make it holy. We'll take the most perverse thing and try to make it right. We'll take the most wrong thing and try to make it right. I have to believe that we, as people, some of us, just don't believe that Jesus was sent by God. Because if we believe that Jesus was sent by God, we wouldn't be in the fix that we are. If we just took the scripture says we're supposed to help the widows and the poor. But we still got people in America that are starving. I began to wonder, why in the most richest country in the world, we got people that don't have enough food? Why in the richest country in the world, we got people in Washington, D.C. trying to not have everybody have health care? Why would you not want people to have good health care, especially when you in D.C. that you got all free health care, but the people down here, little people, us, you don't want us to have health care. I didn't have to believe that they don't believe Jesus was sent by God. Because it said that we're supposed to love one another. How can you love one another when your neighbor is hungry? Your neighbor don't have health care. Your neighbor don't have a job. Your neighbor kids don't have shoes. And you walking around spry and not willing to help. I just believe that the problem is that we don't believe Jesus was sent by God. Matter of fact, we got some people that believe that Jesus was a good man all day. Yep. That he had some good stories to tell. But he wasn't the Son of God. But let me tell you, y'all heard with Connection 3, that he was more than a good man.
All right.
He didn't have no good stories to tell. He was performing miracles.
All right.
And God touched the Holy Spirit to write down those miracles. That's why we have scripture. That's our roadmap. That's why I tell you to always bring your Bible to church. That's your roadmap. Because you ain't got your Bible. Remember how when you go on a trip, you don't know where you're going, and you ain't got no roadmap, you get what? You get lost. Bring your Bible to church. But let me hear you, Connection 3. I have given unto them the word which thou gave me, and they have received them, and they have known surely that I came from thee, and they have believed that thou sent me. This was the final necessary link. The word had dwelt among us. God covenant bond with man had now been sealed. The ecclesiastical revelation of heaven had been poured out upon the earth as Christ was made flesh and dwelt among us. The word was there in the beginning with God, but he had been dispatched from glory to take up residence in a position a little lower than an angel, that man might taste the very presence of God in the flesh. The seal had been broken, and the ecumenical book of salvation had been opened to expose the Savior of the world. For in him was life, and that life was the light of men. These three connections were now completed. God's glory had been revealed, God's power had been manifest, and God's plan had been unveiled. These three were the final connection between man and his God. Only the crucifixion now stood between Christ and his graduation to glory. Ah, here we go.